I would like to call the chairpersons, Dr. Shantaram and Dr. Anand Moses, to chair the session and start.
This is an industry-sponsored symposium where you have two topics. One is the ultra-fast-acting aspart, optimal way to control the postprandial hyperglycemia with Professor S. Venkataraman. And the second topic is insulin co-formulation from convenience to clinical relevance by Professor Krishna Sheshadri. Though the discovery of insulin with many Nobel Stewards credit has changed the management of type 1 diabetes and provided a lifeline to the type 1 diabetics, yet there was inertia in the use of insulin in type 2 diabetics, primarily because of the increase of hypoglycemia and the weight gain, apart from the glycemic variability and the inconvenience in using insulin. This has resulted in the birth of insulin analogs, which to a certain extent reduce the risk of hypoglycemia, reduce the glycemic variability, and improve the flexibility and convenience of using insulin. Now, let us hear from Professor S. Venkataraman whether the new kid in the block, that is ultra-fast-acting insulin aspart, with a rapid onset and offset, with greater insulin exposure in the first 30 minutes, and greater insulin effect in the first 30 minutes, with reduced glycemic excursion, is the appropriate insulin for the control of postprandial hyperglycemia. Professor Venkataraman was formerly professor and HOD, Department of Diabetology, Madras Medical College and Madurai Medical College, and at present is the senior consultant diabetologist, Apollo Green, Chennai. He was and is my teacher with 33 years of postgraduate teaching experience and most sought after speaker, not only in this part of the country, but pan-India, conducting at least not less than 3 CME programs every week in Chennai and weekly journal clubs. Not only sought after by the companies for the CME programs, but also in their ad boards to analyze the data and present it relevantly to the public. Over to you, sir.
Good afternoon once again, and thanks Shanta for the nice introduction. Thank you so much. Thanks, Dr. Anand. I think as we discussed previously, and probably even yesterday, we are fortunate to practice diabetology in an era wherein options are huge. When the option available is going to do something different to the patient in a safe way, without much of a cost, I think the clinicians have every right to opt to that option, and one such option is the ultra-fast-acting insulin by Novo, introduced recently for optimum glycemic control. So maybe in the next 15 minutes, I'll try to cover through the achieving glycemic control, the importance of the fasting as well as the postprandial and the HbA1c, and then with respect to the rapid-acting analogs, how the postprandial has been addressed, and lastly, maybe a few slides with respect to the newer molecule. I think it's fairly known, and we have discussed it even recently. The figures were very alarming. They were in single digits. So a number of subjects were able to achieve the HbA1c target, maybe around 7 or even 7.5 is very low. And you can have a glimpse of the average fasting and the PP blood sugar level from the Indian context. We know that HbA1c is a product of predominantly the fasting as well as the postprandial, and maybe the intermeal variations as well might contribute, so that it will be reasonable to target both to achieve the glycemic target. I think why we emphasize about the postprandial is, previously we always thought, I'm talking about the 80s, I'm sure Professor Shanta and Anand Mose will remember, we had a lot of data, we had our own published data, about 1,000 subjects, fasting plasma sugar correlates with HbA1c. In other words, there was again the terminology that I use, a benign neglect of the postprandial blood sugar level, and subsequently the associations and the availability of the molecules and the huge carbohydrate burden which you're going to see now probably have made us more focused on the postprandial as much as the fasting blood sugar level. This has been projected time and again, how the Indian patients have a high blood sugar level, and then the composition with respect to the carbs, not only in India, across the country, whether it is East, South, West or North. The Monier's data says when you have a fasting blood sugar, I mean your HbA1c very high, the contribution with the fasting is high. So that when the HbA1c is in the vicinity of say around 10, like the case that we discussed, try to catch the fasting first, do your basal insulin or whatever it is, and then once it is closer to 8, target the postprandial. But in the Indian context, whether it is 10 or 10.5 or 8.5, the postprandial contribution is much, much more, so that it makes more sense to target the postprandial. The source of the postprandial blood sugar level, it is not only the dietary intake, the liver needs to be suppressed at that point of the time. Inadequate insulin or insulin action at in the postprandial period also is a huge contributor for the postprandial hyperglycemia, and we need not think only that the carbohydrate composition, silencing the liver is of paramount importance, and insulin or a molecule can do that job, aims to control the postprandial blood sugar level. So this is the approach that one should adopt with respect to the physiological insulin profile, with respect to the postprandial control, the stimulatory as well as the inhibitory and the suppressed signal. So when you want to target postprandial, be cognizant of the postprandial or the carbohydrate load. Certainly lifestyle is absolutely important. Having targeted that, there are some molecules also, but when it comes to insulin, the purpose of the insulin is not only to stimulate the beta cells of the pancreas to release insulin and then aim in the glucose disposal, but also before that, or simultaneously it should silence the liver from producing excess of glucose, which is unwanted in that scenario because already glucose is there. So we have been discussing something about this, the significance of the postprandial or post glucose load association. As I think Krishna said, and we did have a very, very provocative discussion about an hour back, there is not much of evidence, but the concept is there and the association is there. Maybe long-term dedicated studies will vouch for the control of postprandial blood sugar level getting translated into the vascular benefits. As on date, the association is there, the associations are very strong, and we have avenues to target it. Now, when you talk about the postprandial, conventionally, the 2-hour postprandial, we talk about the 2-hour postprandial because a non-diabetic person, when he starts eating, the time taken is about 1.5 to 2 hours to reach the pre-meal level, so that we have a 2-hour postprandial blood sugar level. And presently, we do have some of the guidelines talking about 1 to 2 hours in the postprandial period. So much so, the IDF has taken cognizance of the fact that postprandial blood sugar is important, it is associated with outcomes, so you have to target it. So these are the targets, especially issued by the IDF as well as the ADA. It is not just the 2 hour. Between the first and the second hour, the IDF has been much more aggressive with a target of 160 and the ADA about 180. So compared to the basal insulin, all of us know that when you have a pre-mixed insulin, biphasic or an analog, certainly the prandial component is taken care of. So it may not be a bad option even to initiate insulin with a premixed preparation because you are targeting the fasting as well as the postprandial simultaneously. So advances, similar to the advances in the basal insulin, we have got innovations with respect to the prandial insulin also, that is the bolus insulin. So better postprandial control, as has been alluded to in this meta-analysis, have been witnessed when you compare with biphasic human insulin. And I'm just running through some of these data because I'm going to focus more on the molecule that we are going to discuss today. And then lower HbA1c with insulin aspart, in a meta-analysis, you can see it for yourself, the details. And when you shift from human insulin to regular insulin to a rapid-acting analog, so it is not only for the better postprandial control, it is for a safer achievement of the postprandial control. The risk of hypoglycemia, even though may not be consistent in most of the trials, at least there are some data to suggest that the signals are impressive and it is worth emulating. So the key benefits of the aspart, that is a rapid-acting analog with respect to the human insulin, are depicted here. We know that. So when we talk about the building strong foundation, what we have achieved with a rapid acting analog is, we are always familiar with the graph, which I'll show you sometime now. You have after the injection, the insulin reaches a discernible or a detectable concentration or a meaningful concentration of functional significance, it peaks and then it comes down. Now, if the peaking of the insulin action doesn't coincide with the peaking of the blood sugar level, two things happen. The postprandial control is not achieved. If there's a late peaking, there is an intraprandial hypoglycemia. This has been avoided compared to the regular insulin with the rapid-acting analogs, all the three, aspart, lispro, as well as glulipsin. Now, the clinicians want much more, and the industry rises to the occasion. So, what has been possible is, as I told you, this is the regular insulin, which has got a functional action, say around this time. When you go to a rapid-acting insulin, you have a shift to the left, which means the concentration is detected in the blood earlier, the peak occurs earlier, much closer to the physiological insulin profile, and the effect doesn't last much longer, giving a protection from the pre-meal hypoglycemia. So, when we shifted from regular insulin to the rapid-acting analogs, you had the advantages, and you have these advantages exemplified or enhanced by the ultra-fast-acting insulin, wherein you have a better approach, more or less mimicking the physiological insulin response, so that the early insulin defect about which we are talking a lot, which probably is the one that is responsible for silencing the liver with hepatic glucose production, possibly could be achieved with a kinetic of an insulin, which is there with ultra-fast aspart. Now, whenever we talk about a molecule which is performing better than a similar molecule, you always wonder whether it's a new molecule. With respect to the ultra-fast aspart, as the name itself indicates, it is the same amino acid composition, it is the same aspart. But what has done the trick is addition of a niacinamide, which enables the preservation of the monomers. Monomers are better absorbed, facilitating the entry of the monomers through the microvasculature, so much so, what was depicted in the last slide, that is earlier concentration, earlier peaking, and then exhaustion of the insulin effect by the end of 2 hours, which is what we wanted. And to ensure certain number of stability, arginine has been added. So these are the two molecules which we are too familiar with, and just play or the addition of these molecules has made this difference. This is the pharmacodynamic studies, which means the amount of glucose that is required to be infused to maintain the glucose at a particular level. If you see here with faster aspart, it is much earlier, and so much so, you have the onset of action a bit earlier, 5 minutes earlier, and then if you look at the action at the end of half an hour, almost there is a 74% increase with respect to the GAR. Now, the compelling comparison is, when you compared a regular insulin with aspart, you had the advantages as depicted here, again from the GAR, the glucose infusion rate, the area under the curve is about 40% greater. Do you have a similar quantum of benefit when you compare the new ultra-fast-acting aspart with respect to the regular aspart? The answer is yes. In fact, it is 74% greater. The question is, these are clamp studies, these are GAR, they are experimental studies. Does this 74% benefit which has been witnessed in the clamp studies has been captured in the clinical data? Let us see. The answer is yes. Before that, so there have been a lot of studies. I'm not going to go into the great details. In type 1 and type 2 diabetic subjects, on top of a basal insulin, faster aspart has been compared to in regular aspart. In type 1 diabetics on top of Detimer, and in type 2 diabetics subjects with glargine. So we'll just take these two trials and I'll finish off in another 5 minutes. So there was yet another component. There are the three arms of this particular study. In one arm, the faster aspart was given post-meal to find out whether spacing it, say, around 15 to 20 minutes after the meal, does it have a meaningful postprandial control? Let's see. So these are the inclusion criteria, the key endpoints, which I'm sure you're familiar with. And there was an extension phase in type 1, and this is in type 2. As I told you earlier, there are only two arms. The background was glargine with metformin, and faster aspart was compared with insulin. So these are the baseline characteristics, As you will see here, the HbA1c was around 7.6, mandating a good glycemic control might probably enable the patients to achieve a target of around 7. This is the onset one, the change in the HbA1c. So there was a significantly better reduction in the HbA1c by targeting the postprandial blood sugar level in type 1 diabetic subjects on top of a basal insulin detimer with faster acting aspart compared to the regular aspart. What happened to the type 2 subjects? The HbA1c was more or less the same, the HbA1c was almost the same with respect to the two arms. So you had the HbA1c benefit in type 1 diabetic population when you use this mealtime faster acting aspart. Now, with respect to the 1 hour and 2 hour control, if you're going to plot it, say this is the 0, 1 hour as well as the 2 hour values, you will find out that superior 1 hour and 2 hour values, and now we can recall the recommendations by the IDF as well as the ADA, 1 to 2 hour in the vicinity of 160 or 180 has been recommended. Probably this is yet another tool that will enable you to achieve it. With respect to the type 2 diabetic subjects, at least the 1 hour target was significantly better compared to the aspart in the same on-target trial. Now, this is the comparison with respect to the human insulin vis-a-vis aspart and the faster acting aspart. As you will see here, whatever advantages you had with respect to aspart vis-a-vis biphasic human insulin, the same pattern is being maintained when you switch over to the faster acting aspart. The SMBG profiles, as you will see here, the faster aspart as well as the insulin aspart in type 1 diabetic subjects and as well as in type 2 diabetic subjects, they are more or less overlapping with each other, whereas here, excepting for the lunch, numerically it is better. All the other meal components, there has been a significant reduction in type 1 diabetic subjects with faster acting aspart. Does this benefit accrue out of enhanced insulin dose? No, both in type 1 and diabetic subjects. Does this benefit is associated with a weight gain? No, as you will see here, the weight gain has been more or less the same. And what about the risk of hypoglycemia? You are preponing the arrival of insulin, you are preponing the peaking of insulin, you are timing it in such a way that even the 1 hour value you want to target, does it happen with the increased risk of hypoglycemia? Absolutely no. So, in essence, you have a significant reduction in the HbA1c in type 1 diabetic subjects, more or less a similar HbA1c reduction in type 2 diabetic subjects. Time frames, 1 hour and 2 hour value significantly better in type 1, and 1 hour value significantly better in type 2, without increased risk of hypoglycemia, without increased dose of the basal or the bolus, without additional weight gain. So this is the prescribing characteristics of this insulin extrapolated from the data that we have, which I have presented to you in type 1 and type 2 diabetic subjects. So ladies and gentlemen, when we are in an era of giving our patients whatever we have learned out of concepts, if this could be achieved in a safer way without extra cost to the patient, then it is worth the trial. Faster acting aspart is one such molecule wherein the post meal blood sugar levels are addressed. The kinetics of this insulin, which is the same molecule as aspart, by just a pharmaceutical manipulation of adding a vitamin, you are able to maintain this aspart in a monomeric form, enhancing better absorption and facilitating through the microcirculation probably. So the onset of action is earlier, it peaks earlier, and almost 70% of the effect is over by the 1 hour, and at the end of 2 hours, the effect dies down. The benefits are there, it is safe, and for the same cost, if this the insulin is going to be available, I think that could be the choice of the physicians, not for all patients, in such of those whom you want to have a good postprandial control. Thank you.